This video is brought to you by Crunchyroll. Do you like to watch anime? Or maybe you've wanted to get into it, but you aren't sure where to start? Well, Crunchyroll has got you covered with the biggest catalog of certified classics and new series alike, with no ads, crystal clear 1080p, professional subtitles, and new episodes going live just an hour after they air in Japan. Lately, I've been watching One Piece because I've always wanted to and just never had the time before, and it's fantastic. Its pacing, animation, and its sense of comedic timing are rapidly making it one of my favorite series ever, and I'm still barely scratching the surface. Go to crunchyroll.com/breadsword or click on the link in the description to start your 14-day free trial of Crunchyroll Premium now. That's crunchyroll.com/breadsword or the link in the description to get 2 weeks of anime goodness on the house. Leave a comment below and let me know what you're watching and what other series I should check out. What's your favorite movie? You don't have to answer right away. I'll give you some time to think about it. I love being asked that question, and I think the reason I do is because it's such an annoying thing to ask. It is obnoxious in its clarity, its specificity. It immediately puts you on guard. In an instant, you're forced to weigh the value of all the art you've experienced throughout your life, to appraise it down to the final grain for another person to judge. The flash of guilt for considering the exclusion of a childhood classic, The Aristocats, maybe, or something a little more esoteric, Milo and Otis. The insecurity of passing over the many unambiguous monoliths of the medium to validate the quality of your tastes to whoever asked. Vertigo, The 400 Blows, Ikiru. What if I choose a musical? What does that say about me? A horror? Is that weird? A romance? Do I seem lonely? How could anyone be expected to appoint a diplomat for themselves, the summation of their life's artistic affections up to that moment, in a single work? They can't, honestly. So people change the way they answer it. Top 10 lists, 3x3s, fave 4s, and top 5s abound. A laxer framework, to be sure, one which has since housed countless battles between friends and internet strangers alike across all arts. But what have we changed the question? What is your favorite movie right now? Just today, this hour. What is to you, as the newest version of yourself, an unassailable personal masterpiece? One that feels like it was made just for you to find peace in? One that allows you to become truly lost? I wonder how different the answer would be. Anyways, I'm gonna talk about trains now, so put on your thinking caps and strap in. I'm Really Smart, and this is Howl's Moving Castle, an underrated masterpiece.
The only thing I do is cry. Rain's falling down on my door. When you're so far away, nothing seems to be right. So come on back to me. I can't live a day without you. When you're so far away.
Alright, before we get into the who's, what's, and why's of the flick at hand, we gotta cover the man at its helm. And more importantly, how he got there. Hayao Miyazaki was born in Bunkyo Ward, Tokyo in 1941, the second of four sons. In 1944, just a year before the bombing of Tokyo, his family fled to Utsunomiya City, but after it was bombed as well, they settled in Kanoma City, where Miyazaki Airplane Corporation, ran by Hayao's uncle, was based, likely instilling in him his lifelong love of flying and unmistakably instilling in him his lifelong hate for war. Not long after, he discovered the world of manga, like Tetsuji Fukushima's Sabuku no Mao, The Devil of the Desert, and just like that, Hayao was hooked. Fast forward a dozen or so years, and the animation godfather-to-be enrolled in Gakushuin University in the Department of Political Economy, where he would major in Japanese industrial theory and later graduate with a degree in political science and economics. The university didn't have a manga club, so he joined the Children's Literature Club instead, of which he says he was sometimes the only member. With several thousand pages of uncompleted stories and a poli-sci degree under his belt, he left college in 1963 and was hired on by Toei Animation the same year. His first credited work was as an in-between artist on Daisaku Shirakawa's film Wanwan Chushingura, Doggy March, Within less than a year, he led a major union dispute at the company and became its labor union president with his new friend Isao Takahata, who he referred to as Paku-san due to the sound he made when he ate bread in the mornings, serving as his vice chairman. In 1965, they would work on their first project together, The Great Adventure of Horace, Prince of the Sun. Takahata directed while Miyazaki handled scene design and key animation. 1971, after completing work as a key animator for Hiroshi Shidara's Ali Baba and the 40 Thieves, Miyazaki and Paku-san left Toei in the Dust to join A Production along with Yuichi Kotabe. And later that year, Miyazaki embarked on his first location scouting trip with the then president of Tokyo Movie Corporation. Destination, Sweden. The work he'd flown out to scout for, Pippi Longstocking, never came to fruition, nor did he even get to meet its author while he was there, but the small villages and outdoor museums he had visited struck him so profoundly that the evocation of these environments would become a prominent calling card in almost all of his work to follow. Kiki's hometown, the village of Kuriko, is literally the castle town of Visby on the Swedish island of Gotland, and the city she decides to land in is Stockholm. This also marked the beginning of Miyazaki adapting classic literature to animation, something that would become a trend in Japan at large, beginning with series like Moomin, Dororo, and Miyazaki's very own Heidi, Girl of the Alps. Shout out to World Masterpiece Theater. Anime Little Women went crazy. Eat your heart out, Greta. 73, he blazes a trail abroad once more, to location scout for Heidi in the hills of Switzerland. And in 75, he heads out again, this time to Italy and Argentina, more or less completing his assembly of prevailing external aesthetic influences. And finally, in the year 1979, the world would see them coalesce in a feature-length film. Bro, like, it's so good! Name a better feature-length directorial debut than this. Literally name one. What are you gonna do? Oh, is baby gonna say Citizen Kane? Oh, the Maltese Falcon? Shut up. Shut your mouth. Look at their little car. Look at the dog. Give me your phone. Lupin III, The Castle of Cagliostro isn't just one of the best animated films ever made, it is one of the only animated films where you can see the birth of a goat in real time. This is Michael in his rookie season shit. Miyazaki's career should be examined in two halves, the pre and post Cagliostrian eras. I really like it. Even though the film itself wasn't a commercial success, it cemented him as a director worth knowing outside of television. 1981, Animage ran its first issue devoted to him, titled Hayao Miyazaki, World of Romance and Adventure. And the following February, they published the first issue of Nausicaä of the Valley of the Wind. The editor who helped facilitate their publication, Toshio Suzuki, would quickly become the third piece to Studio Ghibli's Holy Trinity, serving either on the production committee or as the main producer for virtually everything the studio has ever released. 84, Nausicaä of the Valley of the Wind, the movie, takes theaters by storm, marking Hayao's first collaboration with Joe Hisaishi. 85, Miyazaki, Takahata, and Suzuki found Studio Ghibli. 86, Castle in the Sky. 88, My Neighbor Totoro. 89, Kiki's Delivery Service. 92, Porco Rosso. 97, Princess Mononoke. 2001, Spirited Away. No misses. And finally, in 2004, the best animated movie of all time. Howl's Moving Castle is Miyazaki's ninth directed feature, and the 14th to be released by Studio Ghibli, loosely based on Diana Wynne Jones's novel of the same name, following Sophie, a humble hatmaker with a lack of self-confidence but an abundance of idealism, and Howl, a childish wizard whose talents demand of him responsibilities he dare not accept, and who, because of this, spends his life fleeing them. Loosely being the operative word there, because much in the same way that Miyazaki had handled his previous adaptations, this is by no means a faithful recreation of Jones's work. Rather, it is Miyazaki's own reconstruction of it, recycling only its base elements and discarding the rest. Way fewer, way friendlier characters and environments, but placed in a story with much, much more gravity. And I suppose there's no better place to start than that story's beginning. Howl's opens on an extreme wide shot of a mountain, your typical opening establishing shot, except it's almost entirely cloaked beneath a river of dense, flowing fog. The first sound to greet us after that of the low hum of wind as it dashes across the mountain spine is that of machinery. The exhalation of steam and the thunder of towering but clumsy steps, devoid of any specific cadence or harmony. As the melange of sounds draws nearer, a colossus emerges from the fog, lumbering forward with as little visual composure as it has aural. As the gloom dissipates and our golem continues its march, we cut to a close-up from its side, a tracking shot providing us a much clearer view of its many mismatched parts, fastened together by odd-sized rivets and sloppily laid bricks, held aloft by gaunt metal legs. Cut again, we're even closer, the Titan's many independently moving pieces clattering and wailing in full view. The way the camera interacts with the moving castle in these first few shots, spoilers by the way, this is the moving castle, feels less like the introduction of a machine and much more like the introduction of a character. And this is because in Miyazaki's cinematic language, that is exactly what it is. Let me explain. Howl's Moving Castle is a true blue Miyazaki opening, something that I've come to refer to as the Miyazaki 3 shot. From Nausicaa to Moulin Rouge, but with planes, everything Dude Drops opens with this same basic structure. Check it out. Valley of the Wind opens with an extreme wide of a desolate wasteland, with the only figures who don't belong to the natural environment emerging center frame from a sandstorm in the distance. Hold on their approach for about 6 seconds, then cut. Second shot. Now we're up close and personal with that dang horse claw's feet. These are called horse claws, by the way. I didn't know that, but apparently in the manga, they are called horse claws. Cut again, and our third shot is a close-up of our first character. Lord Yupa knows real G's move in silence like lasagna, so he isn't saying a word or batting an eye. And if he and his horse claws are, we're not seeing it, which immediately communicates to the audience that our trio have logged in to the danger zone. Castle in the Sky, same thing, opens with that young EWS, this time a pan. Second shot, we cut in close to whatever disrupted the frame in the first one, this time it's an airship, and with our cut to the third, Miyazaki introduces us to Dola's gang. Due to the ensemble dynamic, we aren't given a medium close like our boy LY, but we are given just as much context. The shot begins on the tiger moth's tail, emblazoned with a skull, the universally agreed upon symbol for pirates. And as the band begins to flood out of the cabin, a siren in the team's body language makes it perfectly clear that whatever our corsairs of the sky are seeking, they've just found. Totoro, you know the deal. We open with an establishing shot of a field, then a subject pierces the static frame from stage right. Second shot, like usual, we're getting closer like Neo. We can infer that whoever this is settling down somewhere new. And with our third, go figure, we're introduced to our first characters. Mary-Kate and Ashley are in the back, but Mom's nowhere in sight, and Big Sis is the one dispersing the sweets. A subtle first pour of the film's foundational emotional dynamic. Kiki's, I bet you can guess. Open wide, rotate, close, then close up. Our first three shots leave us certain of one thing, and it's that this gamer girl's fixing to get the heck out of Dodge. Four films in, Hai has developed a pretty reliable formula, so he starts mixing it up. Porco Rosso, we start like usual. Film opens wide on the sky over the Adriatic Sea, framed on three sides by cliffs and the trees that live atop them. Camera tilts down until it comes to a rest on the subjects that had breached the frame. This is the first time Miyazaki introduces a character in a vehicle in the same opening without the character actually being in it, but he maintains the visual balance of the formula by using their opposing edges to center them in the frame and having them enter it at virtually the same time. Cut to shot number two. It's pan beginning here and ending here. Marco is implicitly bound to the Curtis R3C floating by his feet by the line drawn between them, and his face is obscured from our view because it isn't of any great importance. The third shot is where things really get interesting though. Instead of cutting to a close-up of our character as he's done previously, Miyazaki cuts to a close-up of what this symbiotic relationship represents, what our character pursues. Put succinctly, a life of freedom. Miyazaki would begin to both rely on and reply to the language he had developed in the beginning of his films, to create a dialogue with the viewer by playing on the subconscious expectations he had nurtured. Mononoke and Ponyo's openings both rely on it to expedite the delivery of their message to their audience. They're both still three-shot punch-ins from an extreme wide to a relative close, but there aren't any characters or objects for the camera to focus on. The only thing occupying each of the three opening shots in either film is nature, because nature is the essential character of them. Spirited Away, alternatively, opens with a response to it. A slick fake out and reversal by way of opening on an extreme close-up of nature, a bouquet of flowers, and then pulling them away to reveal a natural landscape, but one that is out of focus and separated from us by a window. The second and third shot are, this time, further away than the first, and all three of them utilize this contrast between the flowers, the nature they belong to, and the deviation from expectation as an illustration of Chihiro's disillusionment with life at the moment and the anxiety of not belonging wherever she's moving to. The opening doesn't feel like it belongs, either. The wind rises, same as the first four. First shot, second shot, third. What's the movie about? The pursuance of dreams. What's the third shot? You already know. This is like the filmmaking equivalent of how like 80% of Pharrell beats start with that little four count.
Star Trek. Niggas is haters. You know
So, back to Howl's Moving Castle. Miyazaki utilizes this cinematic language that he had developed to usher us into this film in a remarkable way. Its opening three shots establish its setting, fundamental theme, its quintessential vehicle, and a delineation of the film's main cast's ambitions via the subversion of the character introduction close-up on the third shot, simultaneously. What Miyazaki had previously accomplished in the openings of four very different films, he's able to concentrate and execute in just one, precisely because he had done these each separately previously. We cut back to an extreme wide, the fog subsiding to reveal radiant, rolling hills of green pasture flanked by snow-capped peaks. As the moving castle continues its trek through the frame, the sounds of the bells of the sheep become incorporated into its symphony of bellows and creaks, as do the birds, as do the strings, as they slowly fade in to complete the soundscape. The shepherd waves to it as it passes, and with our next shot, a calm, bright blue sky, shapes kept deliberately ambiguous as to whether they are steel or feathered, gliding across the cloud-covered frame, the strings withdraw, and a single piano softly takes their place as the title card appears. The characteristic swell that accompanies many of Miyazaki's film's title cards is subverted entirely, instead being delayed until its first reprisal, titled Scroll Through the Sky, when Sophie and Howl first meet. The music is once again accompanied by the arrhythmic heaving of machinery, this time a train, and as the strings return, taking its place, we're taken into the shop opposite the tracks, and an older woman enters the doorway to introduce our protagonist Sophie by name, and oh my god, Miyazaki brief encountered us! It's okay, it's a little shaky, I admit, because the in medias res of Howl's isn't really given its let's go back to the gap moment until like 10-ish minutes before its ending, so it's not in a spiritual sense necessarily in medias res, but like technically it is, and like the idle gossip of the shop begins after Sophie's introduction, not before as it does with Laura, and it trades the tension of adultery for the burden of war, but it's the train, it's the castle. David Lean's brief encounter is brilliant for a lot of reasons. You should watch it if you haven't. But the one that always sticks out to me the most is his use of steam locomotives, their arrivals and their departures, to both bring its lovers together in the first place and represent the explosive, impetuous nature of their love. Every appearance of a train in the film bookmarks another chapter in the development of their romance until the very last departure marks its end. The film contends that above all else, love is accidental and out of the blue. It contains what is surely one of the most romantic exchanges ever put to a screen. Alec, Laura's love interest in the film, the both of them having up to this point spent their time together rather innocently, just as friends, is explaining his vocation for preventative medicine to her, how the coal mines of the town they met in help him study, and there's a point in the middle of his enthusiastic rambling where her eyes widen, like she's just come to this world-ending realization. And then, there it is. She remarks how he looked like a little boy just then, and they both realize within the same instant what's happened. And there's nothing either of them can do about it. They're in love. In this specific respect, this precise delivery of the realization of love as a car accident happening in front of you, I don't think an animated film managed to capture it nearly as well as honestly until Howl's. So it's incredibly fitting that it would also employ the same motif for it. Love, by accident, is the penultimate agent for change in Howl's Moving Castle. This is expressed first by the clumsiness, the coarseness with which the vehicle appointed to represent it traverses its world. This, again, is an inclusion of Miyazaki's. In Jones's writing, the kingdom of Inguri where our story takes place hasn't yet reached the industrial age, so no planes, trains, or automobiles. The castle's movement is never described or given a mechanical source. And second, by the immediate contradiction to Sophie's expectations when she and Howl meet. Due to the greater conflict being war rather than love within constraints, the quarrel between would-be sweethearts juxtaposed against Laura and Alec in the opening of Brief Encounter is replaced by Sophie's sisters exclaiming that they can see Howl's castle in the distance just after she resolves to stay and work while the others leave. Two really crucial introductions happen here, before Sophie and Howl's. First, the development of Howl and Sophie's leitmotif. The strings once again are replaced with a piano, the second note of the same melody we heard during the film's title card, striking in sync with the cut to reaction shot. We haven't even met Howl yet, but the mention of his name alone already evokes this specific musical idea. But pay attention to what is actually said while it plays. How we're introduced to the idea of Howl by the other employees of the shop. Instantly, what we understand from the opening to be a benevolent presence is met with panic. Certainly he shouldn't be so close. He disappeared into the fog, only to hide from the soldiers. Did you hear what happened to Martha? They say he tore out her heart. All uttered as casually as one would say anything else, in spite of the fact that Miyazaki has just shown us this perception of Howl carries with it a very real lethality. The carelessness with which this is delivered, in combination with its brevity, makes it an incredibly easy interaction to assign almost no weight to beyond its use of establishing that Howl is physically close to where Sophie is. With their departure, the train passes again and Sophie leaves, as does the melody. For the next minute and a half straight, Miyazaki screams at us in 7,000 point impact font that the previous interaction we had heard was not actually weightless at all. The second introduction he had made was propaganda, inexorably tied to the romance of our protagonists. Speaking of which, here's Howl, just in time to make sure the soldiers we had seen paraded in town 20 seconds ago don't assault Sophie in an alley. As a side note, I think Howl's maybe the best designed human character in a Miyazaki film for his wardrobe alone. I mean, peep how he comes in a frame. We don't even see his face yet, but you already know how he's coming.
Yes, sir.
Bro said he's getting fits off whether the kingdom wants him dead or not, and honestly, you gotta respect it. Anyways, Howl throws the reverse card at them and we're on our merry way. Except, our studly savior is in hot water as well. The leitmotif's instrumentation has developed from a single piano into an orchestra, first gently ambling along with the pair and then taking on a more hastened, perilous tone as the Witch of the Waste's henchmen begin to close in around them. And what follows is, for my money, the best Hiseishi swell in Miyazaki's entire body of work. Not only is this one of the most disarming and enchanting moments, like, ever, it is also the clearest illustration drawn of the moral disparity within its world and within Miyazaki's worldview. As Howl and Sophie saunter through the air, every kindness that he speaks from now until the moment he leaves her on Chesserie's balcony slowly dispels the malicious beliefs those waltzing beneath them hold towards him. And her subsequent conversation with Letty, her sister, immediately doubles down on this contrast. Miyazaki allows for no idle time to pass. There is no ambiguity. Letty's question to Sophie, "Are you sure he wasn't a wizard?" is countered by Sophie simply remarking, "He was so kind. He rescued me." If it was Howl, Letty continues, he would have eaten her heart right up. To these people, these two things are mutually exclusive. There can't be nice wizards or witches unless they're firmly under the kingdom's thumb, and this goes especially for those who don't support its belligerent militarism. If who the state sees as the enemy is actually harmless, simply wishing to live free of conflict, then that would mean she's wrong, and her countless wealthy consumers clad in opulent military regalia are perpetuating violence, profiting from and being celebrated for perpetuating violence over a lie. And that could never happen in a kingdom like Ingrie. Anyways, Sophie heads back to Lids and the Witch of the Waste pays her a visit because she suspects her of stealing her man. I'm like in love with this moment because usually when Miyazaki introduces his initially predominant antagonist that becomes a supporting character halfway through the film, because he literally always does that, there's a clear conflict that they're engaged in that has nothing to do with harming the protagonist. They're never fundamentally unkind people, they're just desperate. So it's hilarious that in Howl's Moving Castle, our opening antagonist just pulls up on Sophie with the most I am a villain fit possible and proceeds to fuck her whole life up for a reason we not only understand is irrational, but that Sophie doesn't understand at all. She doesn't know that her henchmen were the ones following Howl, only we do. This is just a stranger she's heard about going, "I think I will cause problems on purpose," and then leaving for 40 minutes of screen time. It's perfect. Which brings me to my next point on my big list of why Howl's Moving Castle is the best Miyazaki film and everyone is wrong except me. It's like genuinely funny. This isn't a knock at his other movies, obviously, I love them all. But due to either tone or target demographic, depending on the work, there aren't exactly a lot of opportunities for laughs throughout Miyazaki's filmography. At most, we get cute funny, as is the case with films like Totoro or Ponyo, where the actions of an exaggerated animal character make you giggle because it's cute, or brief moments of extreme visual comedy, like in Porco Rosso, Castle in the Sky, and Spirited Away. Quick, slapstick, I can't believe that happened laughs. Even then, these are rare occurrences, so his films rely almost solely on their optimism, color palette, and music to pump that sweet serotonin into our tired brains. And that's not a problem, because he and the teams who created them are so talented at evoking happiness through these other means that comedy writing, you know, situational, conflict-based comedy, isn't usually vital to their execution. But that couldn't work with Howl's Moving Castle. Without these interactions, you know, without the main villain's goofy dog, Heen, being mistaken as Howl in disguise for like 7 full minutes, without Sophie and the Witch of the Waste's stare bit, or their ridiculous introduction to each other, without Howl's literal meltdown over Sophie mixing up his dyes, or his impersonation of the king being extremely eloquent and well-composed, only for the actual king to enter moments later and reveal to us that he is a loud, brash idiot, all while everyone in the room already knew he wasn't the king, and this is immediately following us in Sophie realizing Heen wasn't Howl, without the dry sarcasm of Calcifer, or the childish goofiness of Markle, or the exasperation of Sophie, with all three of them, the tonal balance Howl manages to achieve would all but fall apart. It was Mel Brooks who said, "Tragedy is if I cut my finger, comedy is if I fall in an open sewer and die." And I think that expresses not just the innate charm of severe circumstances in comedy, but the innate charm of comedy in severe circumstances. Howl's being much more deliberately funny, containing actual interactions and plot beats made to be comedic, is because Howl's Moving Castle is his most undiminished and straightforward expression of how not fucking cool things are, responding to a specific, real-world cataclysm happening at the time of its creation. In terms of darkness, this is where Miyazaki reached his maximum depth, and these fragments of light are the glue by which the vessel is held together. So, let's rip off a band-aid, shall we? Howl's Moving Castle is about the Iraq War. That isn't an opinion. Here's Miyazaki saying why he didn't accept his Oscar for Spirited Away. He detests right-wing governments, which should be obvious from his work, including the leader of his own, who only seems vaguely liberal to Americans in comparison to the triple S Devil May Cry combo of violent, bigoted sociopaths that have ran our country since its inception. And he's more than equipped to express why, hence my specification of his background of study and his victimhood at the hands of our empire's injudicious slaughter of civilians, which he criticizes so precisely in defense of those who weren't given the same chance. The king is George W. Bush. Madame Solomon is a mixture of Dick Cheney and Donald Rumsfeld. We're never told what the name of the neighboring kingdom that Ingry wages its violence against is because it doesn't really matter. We know what it really is. Another decision of Miyazaki's. It has a name in the book, but in the book, the issue of war is only peripherally referred to. Howl's disappearances are because in the book, he is a womanizer. His summons is to simply find the king's missing brother. The rumors about him are spread by himself. The reasons he avoids his quote, responsibility to his kingdom are because he's fickle and self-absorbed. The changes made in the film to soften Howl's demeanor, to make him resent war so deeply, and instead let the perception of him by the people of Ingry serve as a meditation on state-disseminated misinformation to justify abuse at its hands in the way it contorts otherwise well-meaning people into paranoid and hateful nationalists, ever more entrenched in the belief that their vitriolic worldviews are normal, even righteous, are inspired and agonizingly prescient 16 years later. In spite of this, somehow, it is still an extraordinarily comforting film to watch. Calcifer is, without exaggeration, the best non-human sidekick in the history of film. I mean, every good adventure has one, right? Why do you think Torchlight slaps as hard as it does? Because it's fun to play? No. How about because I can get a cat and make it wear a fucking backpack? It's basic storytelling. Calcifer fulfills the same party role, so to speak, and was similarly changed to become a much warmer presence in the film, something that complements his existence as a literal fire pretty well. I think what allows Calcifer to so quickly endear himself to us, though, is that he exists at the crossroads of two of humanity's most beloved storytelling tropes, one half Androcles and the Lion, the interdependent relationship between a human and a beast, typically one they've saved who then comes to their rescue in return at a later point in the story. Basically that Pokemon episode where Bruno tames an Onix after pulling a Sandslash out of its side, but like boring and Roman and historically significant or whatever. If you've seen How to Train Your Dragon, you get the gist. And the other half, the Theft of Fire, probably most popularly known in the West as Hesiod's Myth of Prometheus, an allegory meant to consecrate humanity's everlasting hunger for knowledge and the mastery of our own fates, no matter the cost. For his crime of stealing fire from Zeus and delivering it to the humans in a giant fennel stalk, the titan Prometheus was bound to a rock, where every day an eagle, the symbol of Zeus, would eat his liver, only for it to regenerate at night and be eaten again the next morning. In ancient Greece, the liver was often thought to be the center for human emotion, so Prometheus's punishment, adapted to modern poetic language, would likely depict him losing his heart in exchange for the key to unlock humanity's potential instead. The combination of two of our most captivating tropes, packaged as the universal illustration of coziness with an extremely cute face in the characterization of every cartoon cat that has ever existed, who is then given the ability to wield magic, cook the best looking breakfast I have ever seen, and pilot a castle. Hayao can't help but put up threes. Howl's Moving Castle's score is brilliant as well. Joe Hisaishi's compositions perfectly capture Howl's being not only Miyazaki's most unabashedly romantic film, but his most extreme, both in its crests and its depressions. He reprises and develops upon Howl and Sophie's leitmotif in 15 of the score's 26 tracks, and those which lie under its darker moments are incredibly intense and disorienting in contrast to its predominantly gentle and whimsical soundscape. The first example of this contrast actually being the second song heard in the film, the only piece of diegetic music in Howl's. Sophie leaves her hat shop, and after a short bus ride into town, just before she's accosted by two of the four Beatles, she's met with the aforementioned parade for Ingry's military. Its music bears no resemblance to the instrumentation we had just been ushered into the film by, and its just slightly uncomfortably loud horn section, its crashing cymbals, and its garish strings and flutes arpeggiating beneath the fanatical chanting of the crowd, along with Sophie's determination to pay no attention to it, make for a genuinely unsettling musical identity. This doesn't feel normal, no matter how much everyone here thinks or wants to think that it is. It's not explicitly dark, as the remaining pieces of the score pertaining to Ingrid's hawkishness and the damage it causes are, but it establishes, immediately after we're introduced to Howl and Sophie's theme, that whatever this is contradicts it. And as the film progresses, as the malevolent nature of this power structure is revealed to Sophie, what were once subtle imperfections on the surface unravel to become horrifying shrieks of string sections racing through our ears and completely overwhelming whatever light atmosphere may have existed prior to this moment. There can be no mistake made as to who the source of strife in this world is. This goes a long way in The Witch of the Waste's early development in particular. Given her limited screen time and how much of her arc depends on the moment following her reintroduction, which then immediately triggers Madame Solomon going mask off, to which Sophie responds with her "you looked like a boy just then" brief encounter love awakening, a lot is riding on the brief window of time the characters spend with her, or speaking of her, before this 50-minute mark light switch. So while the Kingdom of Ingrid carries this very much separate aural footprint, The Witch of the Wastes, though still mischievous, is portrayed musically by the same sounds that Howl, Sophie, and the rest are. Again, the true enemies in all of Miyazaki's works are never the disorganized criminals or desperate outcasts that his secondary antagonists are comprised of, but the systems that deliberately perpetuate the conditions which create them. I think its visuals are crazy cool too. Howl's Moving Castle truly is a culmination of everything Miyazaki had made leading up to it. Nearly all the environments were inspired by his trips abroad for previous projects. This shot in its opening sequence looks more like the Swiss landscapes of Heidi Girl of the Alps than anything he had directed since Cagliostro. The fields of flowers surrounding Star Lake, Howl's secret garden where he grew up, are expressive of those in Sweden, which Kiki begins her film laying atop of. The city of Porthaven is a mixture of coastal villages in Italy and Argentina, trips he had taken for Porco Rosso and his scene design work on Takahata's 3,000 Leagues in Search of Mother. And fittingly, Market Shipping and the royal capital of Kingsbury are an amalgam of French, German, and Austrian architecture, inspired by the Alsace region of France, which he traveled to for this film, the last he would direct based somewhere other than Japan. Howl's was produced digitally, but because it's Miyazaki, everything from its backgrounds to its characters was drawn and painted by hand, then scanned, then manually retouched after it had been digitally assembled to make sure that not even a single frame felt inhuman or artificial. Its use of color, its lush greens, brilliant blues, smoldering reds, and tenebrous blacks paint an almost tangibly lucid spectrum of emotion. The scenes of Howl fighting the many wizards and witches who serve Ingrid are suffocating. Their depiction of darkness and heat so exquisite that there is a palpable sense of relief when Miyazaki cuts away from them. Every environment, every room is exhaustively unique and ornate. The scope of detail in Howl's room alone is like genuinely insane. No two places, not even exterior shots within the wastes, feel similar, and this allows its revisitation of locations to feel even more substantial. The interior of the moving castle, both pre and post transformation, is one of the most relaxing environments rendered in ink. It begs to be lived in. Every environment in the film does. That's what makes their destruction, even the mere presence of warships within them, feel so immediately, so oppressively bleak. And the castle itself, as contrasted against the palace of Kingsbury and Howl's counterpart, is a brilliant expression of the film's main theme. Appearances are often misleading, but substance never is. People are messy and multifaceted and weird, all with our own blemishes and scars and aches and mistakes and traumas, but within whatever shell we've been given, we're capable of fostering so much love, and we're still able to ignite and sustain that love even after anguish or fear has stolen it from us or stripped us of the armored edifices we spend so long cobbling around our anxious selves. Howl's Moving Castle is the breadth of the human experience on four goofy little legs, and I love it. And I love the characters who reside in it. I love how effortlessly it builds and continues to build this eclectic family of what the kingdom rejects. A cursed, love-struck hatter who doesn't believe her life was meant for excitement or love, but shows such compassion to everyone she meets. A grandma whose vindiction was sapped away with much of her strength, but whose knowledge of magic is still only matched by the boyish radical who's in love with the hatter and still cuts his hair like he's Solomon's apprentice, whose charm is only matched by the luminance of his ideals. A child wizard whose unconvincing disguise and inability to cloak his excitement carry such a playful energy into every scene he's a part of. A scarecrow with a turnip for a head who, along with Heen the dog, carries greater narrative significance in the last minutes of the film than almost any other characters. And a fire demon who spends so much of his time making snide remarks and complaining that he hardly realizes he's come to love his life with the family that has assembled around him. I love that Howl's fight in many ways echoes Ashitaka's from Princess Mononoke, the physical reflection of their respective hate of violence and the pain it causes them to contribute to its venomous cycle. I love the confidence and the joy that Sophie finds in herself as she grows and realizes her potential, and I love that her curse is so cliché that the secret to breaking it is simply falling in love. Because all the best ones are. I love that their love transcends both the curses they bear, even prior to their breaking, allowing Sophie to forget the aches and pains she had felt at the age she was cursed to live as, like halfway through the film, gradually returning to her form as the intensity of her heart grows, and Howl to retain his humanity longer than either he or Calcifer could have predicted. In the moment when Howl is leaving to protect the castle from the bombs falling overhead, and Sophie pleads in vain for him to stay because she's the reason he won't, Miyazaki manages to so perfectly capture the simultaneous ecstasy of loving someone with your whole heart and the paralyzing terror of knowing that that person loves you back. I love that its sound design and Miyazaki's framing of the different vehicles within Howl's so clearly separates artistic feats of engineering from the brutal apparatuses of war. The castle, the train, the cars, every vessel of peace has its own idiosyncratic symphony of heaves and grates that harmonize with the nature that surrounds them and with the score of the film as they underscore the flowering romance of our protagonists, while every warship carries a tiresome, steady hum. A tone devoid of life because they only exist to end it. And Miyazaki's rumination on this, the ease with which their crews were consumed or misled by malice, gives the film's appeal to mercy all the more weight. It's commentary on the severity and the permanence of the transformation wizards and witches undergo to fight. Their total loss of self, if prolonged, is an allegory for the PTSD that has torn its way through both kingdoms in the aftermath. In his book Starting Point, Miyazaki describes how much the atmosphere of wartime Japan scared him, not just because of the destruction it had wrought, and how much his people, innocents with no say, were made to suffer in return by the US's hand, but by how easily he felt he would have been radicalized by the same imperial propaganda had he been born only a little earlier. How effortless it could have been to shape his compassion into prejudice.
Every Muslim is a terrorist.
Period. Right now.
Shut your mouth.
Yes,
I don't want to hear your mouth.
Oh, please.
I'm done with you.
And that's a really scary admission to make. He describes Bush as a man possessed by the ghost of John Wayne, telling him that this is the way a real man should act. Over a million civilians' blood on his hands, for weapons he knew were never there. In his article, The Psychology of Propaganda, Dr. Raymond Dodge writes to us of World War I, 100 years in the future. Paper bullets, according to Mr. Creel, won the war, but they have forever disturbed our peace of mind. The war is long since over, all but saying so, but our consciousness of the imminence of propaganda bids fair to be permanent. He goes on to say, a cartoon discloses the anatomy of propaganda more completely than any other kind. I think Howl's Moving Castle is an irrefutable validation of this. I really love Howl's Moving Castle, and I really do think it is Miyazaki's best work. A lot of friends I talk to about Miyazaki's top five always seem to mention Howl's as one of his weakest, and it drives me crazy, hence the title. It's underrated relative to where I see it. The top rung. Lately, though, I've been watching it a lot. I mean, it's always been a comfort film for me, but this year I've just watched it a whole lot. I think when we're in pain or overwhelmed, we either look for an escape to feel like we aren't in the life we're in, or we seek a reflection of that life to meditate on, to seek therapy for our problems by seeing them cast in a different light. It's just that it's such a reassuring movie, you know? In spite of its subject matter being so grim, it's still Miyazaki's most optimistic work. The Center for Public Integrity estimated that in a 2-year period, the Bush administration made 935 different false statements about Iraq's alleged capability to pose a threat to us. On 9/11, Rumsfeld famously demanded the National Security Council give him a good enough reason not to strike Iraq in retaliation, even though he knew they had no connection to it. The list of war crimes they paved the way for is too innumerable to fathom. But in Howl's, love changes even the orchestrators of its strife. Turnip reveals himself to be a lost prince of the neighboring kingdom, and Solomon is reminded of her heart by seeing that Howl never truly lost his. They decide to stop the war, which she admits was without reason, and the conflict is just resolved. That's it. There's no weird, bittersweet compromise where the protagonists return to their mundane lives, or, you know, like one of them dies, or fate ordains that they must stay apart to maintain a balance, or whatever. It's like Brief Encounter if it ended the way everyone wants Brief Encounter to end, right? In the Mood for Love, Lost in Translation, La La Land, whatever. And you know, maybe it's better that it doesn't, maybe that's what gives it some of its brilliance, is that it can't last, but I'm just so tired of that. Because when the movie ends, maybe the administration responsible never faces any kind of even vague repercussion outside of a fucking Green Day single. And maybe the one in place now is just as barbaric. So much so that it's currently threatening to imprison members of the International Criminal Court for even trying to inquire about those war crimes. Maybe its response to a global pandemic was to inspire paranoia about the validity and severity of its every aspect, to further propagandize its citizenry of anxious, hyper-individualist nationalists, and now 164,000 are dead with no end in sight, and the observations of the world scientists are blasphemy to the king. Maybe we aren't just living in the same world as the Sea of Decay, but we are residing on its banks and the tide's coming in. Maybe when you wake up and try to order food so you can avoid potentially exposing yourself to the virus your kingdom will allow to kill 1,300 of its people today, it can't be picked up because the hands of the king shot a man in his chest for having a mental breakdown in front of the restaurant. They could have just tased him, but they don't care. And everyone knows it except the people who don't want to, because that would mean they're wrong. And that could never happen in a kingdom like Ingry. Maybe the virus costed your job, maybe your credit rating dropped, maybe you lost a friend, maybe you even lost your Sophie or your Howl. So you just immerse yourself in a world where that doesn't happen. Where the people who shape the reality you're visiting magically develop moral compasses and then follow them to make decisions that are kind and inspire kindness. Where you still have whatever it is you lost. Or at least have grown past the hurt of losing it. But that isn't life. So, I think I'm ready to stop watching it soon. Miyazaki once said of his work, "My foundation is this. I want to send a message of cheer to all those wandering aimlessly through life." Howl's is undoubtedly that. It doesn't just show us an alternate reality to criticize ours. It shows us what ours can come to be. As we arrive at its end, their moving castle is rebuilt, ascending from its ruins to soar into a brighter future than the present they're leaving behind, as the visual dichotomy from their initial convergence is given its encore. The outfits of our protagonists exchange for ones which represent cheerfulness, love, and hope. I think everyone needs an escape sometimes, a weighted blanket in the form of images and sounds. And if you've been spending more time in yours than usual this year, I feel you. You should know that no matter how corny it feels to watch The Office over and over again instead of something new, I understand the comfort of knowing that Pam Beasley is gonna turn out fine. It's supplementary to the uncertainty that you will. But you will. Fragments of Light, right? When I was 8, my favorite movie was a goofy movie because my dad lived 1,000 miles away and I missed him. When I was 13, it was The Lord of the Rings, The Return of the King, because I wanted to feel brave and well-liked like Gimli. My favorite movie right now is Howl's Moving Castle, because I needed it to be. What's yours?
Oh, the good life, full of fun, seems to be the ideal. Yes, the good life, lets you hide all the sadness you feel. You won't really fall in love.
Hey, thanks for watching. Big thank you to my patrons for making this video possible, especially these guys. And a very special thank you to Sham Kumar, Unknown, Grady B. Olson, Grand Shock Trooper, Reverse Polarity, Bean, Aiden Sales, The Queen, William Rulon, David Maynard, Ram Liko Grady, Danyan Dimitru, Sawyer Coast, Sergeant VR, Jake Pitch, Jordan May, Amy Wen, Ethan Gay, Jeremy Wilkins, Cedar Tierney, Nathan Martin, Peyton Williams, Hunter, Christian Wells, That One French Guy, Koala Bala, Saints, Nicholas Lewis, SSGT Snuggles, Dustin Treese, Austin Hart, Elizabeth, Alexander Reed, Ayoshi, Brian the Epic, Adam Lutzow, Johnny B. Good, Ryan Randolph, Liam the Child, Clunt, Too Fast, Too Quick, Senior Gambino, Enrique Gomez, Meshock Brooks, Zian Employee, Preston McElizio, Skelly V, Gregory Babcock, oh what's up Gregory, VHS Daydreams, Gianni Ariella, Holden Williams, Gweister, Aaron Brennan, Stephanie Langdew, Tyler Eaton, Walter J. Taggart, Patrick Foster, Vintage Me, Ethan Boyd, Ethan Jones, Yuri Voice, Granule, Lauren Gudakos, Ivan Dolvich from Jagged Alliance 2, Jack Dixon, Tyra Rogers, Preshtail, LW, Benjamin Reed, Mitchell Alley, Dante Cantone, Kintsugi, Dr. J, Amanda Panda, Luke Hudson, Space Ghost, Madeline Foley, Jordan Carter, Alex Fenn, The DJ, Lakota Rawls, Kevin Thurber, Quinn Whiteley, Heaven Johnson, Diego Arras, Simon Riley, Alexi Ara Olavi, Buttershield, Maximum Crash, Kane King, The One Who Memes, Lewi, Avery Cusant, I Am Badgers, Jack Buckets, Nick Bell, Luigi Murray, Michelle Wen, Mohamed El Zafri, Avid, No Community, Jacob New, Tristan VS, Robert Whaley, Straffin Nathan, Tristan Marino, Joshua Kodamal, Blake Demby, Gavin Miller, Long Hyun, Ho Shin, Shane Vino, Mumblecore Max, Charles J. Boyle, and Travis Osborne. Let me know what you thought about what I thought down below. Make sure to subscribe if you feel like seeing more slick vids like the one you just watched. And if you really want to help out, consider becoming a patron. Every penny helps me try to make this thing a full-time gig. Anyways, love you, and have a good night.